Republican vice presidential candidate Sarah Palin kept up her busy schedule today, meeting with several world leaders who are here in New York for the UN session. But she took time out for an interview, and we talked about the financial crisis at length. We began, though, with reports that the lobbying firm of Senator McCain's campaign manager received payments as recently as last month from mortgage giant Freddie Mac, even as it was failing. I asked for her reaction during our exclusive interview.
My understanding is Rick Davis recused himself from the dealings in that firm, I don't know how long ago, a year or two ago, and that he's not benefiting from that. And, you know, I would hope that that's the case.
But he still has a stake in the company, so isn't that a conflict of interest?
Again, my understanding is that he recused himself from the dealings with Freddie and Fannie, any lobbying efforts on his part there, and I would hope that that's the case, because as John McCain has been saying, and as I've been in on a much more local level, been also rallying against, is the undue influence of lobbyists in public policy decisions being made.
Then we focused on the $700 billion government bailout of bad debt, and I asked her if she supports it.
I'm ill about the position that America is in, and that we have to look at a $700 billion bailout. At the same time, we know that inaction is not an option. And as Senator McCain has said, unless this nearly $1 trillion bailout is what it may end up to be, unless there are amendments in Paulson's proposal, really, I don't believe that Americans are going to support this, and we will not support this. The interesting thing in the last couple of days that I have seen is that Americans are waiting to see what John McCain will do on this proposal. They're not waiting to see what Barack Obama is going to do. You know, is he going to do this and just see what way the political winds blow? They're waiting to see if John McCain will be able to see these amendments implemented in Paulson's proposal.
Why do you say that? Why are they waiting for John McCain and not Barack Obama?
He's got the track record of the leadership qualities and the pragmatism that's needed at a crisis time like this.
But polls have shown that Senator Obama has actually gotten a boost as a result of this latest crisis, with more people feeling that he can handle the situation better than John McCain.
I'm not looking at poll numbers. What I think Americans at the end of the day are going to be able to go back and look at track records and see who's more apt to just be talking about solutions and wishing for and hoping for some opportunity to change, and who's actually done it.
If this doesn't pass, do you think there's a risk of another Great Depression?
Unfortunately, that is the road that America may find itself on. Not necessarily this, as it's been proposed, has to pass, or we're going to find ourselves in another Great Depression. But there has got to be action taken, bipartisan effort, Congress not pointing fingers at this point at one another, but finding the solution to this, taking action, and being serious about the reforms on Wall Street that are needed.
Would you support a moratorium on foreclosures to help average Americans keep their homes?
That's something that John McCain and I have both been discussing, whether that is part of the solution or not. You know, it's going to be a multifaceted solution that has to be found here.
So you haven't decided whether you'll support it or not? What are the pros and cons of it, do you think?
Some decisions that have been made poorly should not be rewarded, of course. At the same time,
by consumers, you're saying?
Consumers and those who were predator lenders also. That has to be considered also. But again, it's got to be a comprehensive, long-term solution found for this problem that America is facing today. As I say, we are getting into crisis mode here.
You've said, quote, John McCain will reform the way Wall Street does business. Other than supporting stricter regulations of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac 2 years ago, can you give us any more examples of his leading the charge for more oversight?
I think that the example that you just cited with his warnings 2 years ago about Fannie and Freddie, that's paramount. That's more than a heck of a lot of other senators and representatives did for us.
But he's been in Congress for 26 years. He's been chairman of the Powerful Commerce Committee, and he has almost always sided with less regulation, not more.
He's also known as the Maverick, though, taking shots from his own party and certainly taking shots from the other party, trying to get people to understand what he's been talking about, the need to reform government.
I'm just going to ask you one more time, not to belabor the point, specific examples in his 26 years of pushing for more regulation.
I'll try to find you some and I'll bring them to you.
As we stand before this august building and institution, what do you see as the role of the United States in the world?
I see the United States as being a force for good in the world. And as Ronald Reagan used to talk about, America being the beacon of light and hope for those who are seeking democratic values and tolerance and freedom. And I see our country being able to represent those things that can be looked to as that leadership, that light needed across the world.
In preparing for this conversation, a lot of our viewers and internet users wanted to know why you did not get a passport until last year. And they wondered if it indicated a lack of interest and curiosity in the world.
I'm not one of those who maybe came from a background of, you know, kids who perhaps graduate college and their parents get them a passport and give them a backpack and say, go off and travel the world. No, I've worked all my life. In fact, I've usually had two jobs all my life until I had kids. I was not a part of, I guess, that culture. The way that I have understood the world is through education, through books, through mediums that have provided me a lot of perspective on the world.
Governor Palin, you've had a very busy week and you're meeting with many world leaders. You met with President Karzai of Afghanistan. I know the McCain campaign has called for a surge in Afghanistan, but that country is, as you know, dramatically different than Iraq. Why do you believe additional troops, U.S. troops, will solve the problems there?
Because we can't afford to lose in Afghanistan, as we cannot afford to lose in Iraq either. These central fronts on the war on terror. And I asked President Karzai, is that what you are seeking also? That strategy that has worked in Iraq that John McCain had pushed for, more troops, a counterinsurgency strategy? And he said yes. And he also showed great appreciation for what America and American troops are providing in his country.
The United States is deeply unpopular in Pakistan. Do you think the Pakistani government is protecting Al-Qaeda within its borders?
I don't believe that new President Zardari has that mission at all. But no, the Pakistani people also, they want freedom. They want democratic values to be allowed in their country also. They understand the dangers of terrorists having a stronghold in regions of their country also. And I believe that they too want to rid not only their country, but the world of violent Islamic terrorists.
What specifically, in your view, could be done to convince the new government in Pakistan to take a harder, tougher line against terrorists in that country?
At a time when new leadership comes in, that is the opportunity to forge better, tighter, more productive relationships. And that's what we'll take advantage of with new leadership in the U.S. and in Pakistan. And I'm sure that President Zardari, too, will agree with us as we commit to the support that Pakistan needs, that other nations in the region need in order to win this war on terrorism.
You've cited Alaska's proximity to Russia as part of your foreign policy experience. What did you mean by that?
That Alaska has a very narrow maritime border between a foreign country, Russia, and on our other side, the land boundary that we have with Canada. It's funny that a comment like that was kind of made to, reporters.
Mocked.
Yeah, mocked, I guess that's the word, yeah.
Well, explain to me why that enhances your foreign policy credentials.
Well, it certainly does, because our next door neighbors are foreign countries. They're in the state that I am the executive of. And
have you ever been involved with any negotiations, for example, with the Russians?
We have trade missions back and forth. We do. It's very important when you consider even national security issues with Russia, as Putin rears his head and comes into the airspace of the United States of America, where do they go? It's Alaska. It's just right over the border. It is from Alaska that we send those out to make sure that an eye is being kept on this very powerful nation, Russia, because they are right there. They are right next to our state.
When President Bush ran for office, he opposed nation building, but he has spent, as you know, much of his presidency promoting democracy around the world. What lessons have you learned from Iraq, and how specifically will you try to spread democracy throughout the world?
Specifically, we will make every effort possible to help spread democracy for those who desire freedom, independence, tolerance, respect for equality. That is the whole goal here in fighting terrorism also, is not just to keep the people safe, but to be able to usher in democratic values and ideals around the world.
But what lessons do you think you have learned as you've watched this unfold in terms of implementing a democracy and the challenges inherent in that goal?
Well, one is that America cannot be counted on to do this solely, to be the savior of every other nation, but we need friends and we need allies and we need this nation building effort, and we need to forge new alliances, and that is what a new election will provide opportunity to do.
What happens if the goal of democracy, Governor Palin, doesn't produce the desired outcome? For example, in Gaza, the U.S. pushed hard for elections and Hamas won.
Yeah, well, especially in that region, though, we have got to protect those and support those who do seek democracy and do seek protections for the people who live there. And, you know, we're seeing today, in the last couple of days here in New York, a speaker, a president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, who would come on our soil and express such disdain for one of our closest allies and friends, Israel. And we're hearing the evil that he speaks. And if hearing him doesn't allow Americans to commit more solidly to protecting the friends and allies that we need, especially there in the Mideast, then nothing will. If Americans are not waking up to understand what it is that he represents, then nothing is going to wake us up, and we will be lulled into some kind of false sense of security that perhaps Americans were a part of before 9/11.
You met with former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, who is for direct diplomacy with both Iran and Syria. Do you believe the U.S. should negotiate with leaders like President Assad and Ahmadinejad?
I think with Ahmadinejad personally, he is not one to negotiate with. You can't just sit down with him with no preconditions being met. Barack Obama is so off base in his proclamation that he would meet with some of these leaders around our world who would seek to destroy America, and without preconditions being met. That's beyond naive, and it's beyond bad judgment.
So are you saying Henry Kissinger is naive for supporting that?
I've never heard Henry Kissinger say, yeah, I'll meet with these leaders without preconditions being met. Diplomacy is about doing a lot of background work first and shoring up allies and positions and figuring out what sanctions perhaps could be implemented if things weren't going to go right. That's part of diplomacy.
Why shouldn't the U.S. talk to the Syrians if the Israelis are? And couldn't that help to further isolate Iran?
We will speak with the Syrians. We will speak with these countries as preconditions are met, though.
You recently said three times that you would never, quote, second guess Israel if that country decided to attack Iran. Why not?
We shouldn't second guess Israel's security efforts, because we cannot ever afford to send a message that we would allow a second Holocaust, for one. Israel has got to have the opportunity and the ability to protect itself. They are our closest ally in the Mideast. We need them, they need us, and we shouldn't second guess their effort.
You don't think the United States is within its rights to express its position to Israel? And if that means second guessing or discussing an option?
No, absolutely. We need to express our right and our concerns. And
but you said never second guess them.
We don't have to second guess what their efforts would be if they believe that it is in their country and their allies, including us, all of our best interest to fight against a regime, especially Iran, who would seek to wipe them off the face of the earth. It is obvious to me who the good guys are in this one and who the bad guys are. The bad guys are the ones who say Israel is a stinking corpse and should be wiped off the face of the earth. That's not a good guy who is saying that. Now, one who would seek to protect the good guys in this, the leaders of Israel and her friends, her allies, including the United States, in my world, those are the good guys.
The day began early. After being briefed by her staff, Sarah Palin heads out with her 14-year-old daughter Willow in tow.
So nice to meet you too. I didn't realize you were going to be coming along. That's exciting. Are you having a good time with all this?
It's so fun.
Is it really?
Yeah, I love it.
8 a.m., she hits the ground running.
Do you have any downtime, though? Do you ever feel like you can actually...
I get to go running every day.
Yeah.
Which is my sanity. Sweat is my sanity.
First, a photo op with hotel staff. Then it's off to the McCain campaign plane, where we were invited up front to ask a handful of questions.
Do you consider yourself a feminist?
I do. A feminist who believes in equal rights, and I believe that women certainly today have every opportunity that a man has to succeed and to try to do it all anyway. And very, very thankful that I've been brought up in a family where gender hasn't been an issue. You know, I've been expected to do everything growing up that the boys were doing. We were out chopping wood, and we were out hunting and fishing and filling our freezer with good wild Alaskan game to feed our family. So it kind of started with that.
In Columbus, the candidates sat down with me for their first joint interview.
Over the weekend, Governor Palin, you said the U.S. should absolutely launch cross-border attacks from Afghanistan into Pakistan to, quote, stop the terrorists from coming any further in. Now, that's almost the exact position Barack Obama has taken and that you, Senator McCain, have criticized as something you do not say out loud. So, Governor Palin, are you two on the same page?
We had a great discussion with President Zardari as we talked about what it is that America can and should be doing together to make sure that the terrorists do not cross borders and do not ultimately put themselves in a position of attacking America again or her allies. And we will do what we have to do to secure the United States of America and her allies.
Is that something you shouldn't say out loud, Senator McCain?
Of course not. But look, I understand this day and age, gotcha journalism. Is that a pizza place? In a conversation with someone who you didn't hear the question very well, you don't know the context of the conversation, grab a phrase. Governor Palin and I agree that you don't announce that you're going to attack another country.
Are you sorry you said it, Governor?
Wait a minute. Before you say, is she sorry she said it? This was a gotcha soundbite that, well, she was
It wasn't a gotcha. She was talking to a voter.
She was in a conversation with a group of people and talking back and forth. And I'll let Governor Palin speak for herself.
In fact, you're absolutely right on. In the context, this was a voter, a constituent, hollering out a question from across an area asking, what are you going to do about Pakistan? You better have an answer to Pakistan. I said, we're going to do what we have to do to protect the United States of America.
You were pretty specific about what you wanted to do, cross-border.
Well, as Senator McCain is suggesting here also, never would our administration get out there and show our cards to terrorists, in this case to enemies, and let them know what the game plan was, not when that could ultimately adversely affect a plan to keep America secure.
What did you learn from that experience?
That this is all about gotcha journalism. A lot of it is, but that's okay too.
Governor Palin, since our last interview, you've gotten a lot of flack. Some Republicans have said you're not prepared, you're not ready for prime time. People have questioned your readiness since that interview, and I'm curious to hear your reaction.
Well, not only am I ready, but willing and able to serve as vice president with Senator McCain, if Americans so bless us and privilege us with the opportunity of serving them, ready with my executive experience as a city mayor and manager, as a governor, as a commissioner or regulator of oil and gas.
This is not the first time that I've seen a governor being questioned by some, quote, expert. I remember that Ronald Reagan was a cowboy. President Clinton was a governor of a very small state that had no experience either. In fact, I remember how easy it was going to be for Bush 1 to defeat him. I still recall, that one. But the point is, I've seen underestimation before. I'm very proud of the excitement that Governor Palin has ignited with our party and around this country. It is a level of excitement and enthusiasm, frankly, that I haven't seen before, and I'd like to attribute it to me. But the fact is that she has done an incredible job, and I'm so proud of the work that she's doing.
Governor Palin, it will take about 10 years for domestic drilling to have an impact on consumers. So isn't the notion of drill, baby, drill a little misleading to people who think this will automatically lower their gas prices and quickly?
This should have started 10 years ago, tapping into domestic supplies that America is so rich in. Alaska has billions of barrels of oil and hundreds of trillions of cubic feet of clean, green, natural gas onshore and offshore. Should have started doing it 10 years ago, but better late than never. It's got to be an all-of-the-above approach to energy independence.
Governor Palin, I know you'd like to see drilling take place in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. And Senator McCain, you oppose this. You call it, quote, one of the most pristine and beautiful parts of the world. Who's right?
Did you expect two mavericks to agree on to agree on everything? we'll be talking more and more about this issue. But for us to agree on everything would make us, I think, a little bit boring. And we're anything, you can say a lot about us, but we're anything but boring.
Speaking of energy, Palin has brought plenty of it to the campaign trail, attracting huge enthusiastic crowds like this one at Capital University.
I strongly support McCain, but I love Governor Palin.
Her trademark feistiness is on display as she delivers a punchy soundbite about her rival, Joe Biden.
I've been hearing about his Senate speeches since I was in, like, second grade.
When you have a 72-year-old running mate, is that a kind of a risky thing to say? It's insinuating that Joe Biden's been around a while?
Oh, no, it's nothing negative at all. He's got a lot of experience, and just stating the fact there that we've been hearing his speeches for all these years. So he's got a tremendous amount of experience, and, you know, I'm the new energy, the new face, the new ideas, and he's got the experience.
And when it comes to establishing your worldview, I was curious, what newspapers and magazines did you regularly read before you were tapped for this to stay informed and to understand the
I've
world?
I've read most of them, again, with a great appreciation for the press, for the media.
But like what ones specifically? I'm curious that you...
All of them, any of them that have been in front of me over all these years. I have a vast variety of sources where we get our news to. Alaska isn't a foreign country where it's kind of suggested, it seems like, wow, how could you keep in touch with what the rest of Washington, D.C. may be thinking and doing when you live up there in Alaska? Believe me, Alaska is like a microcosm of America.
Our conversation continued aboard the campaign bus.
What's your position on global warming? Do you believe it's man-made or not?
Well, we're the only Arctic state, of course, Alaska, so we feel the impacts more than any other state up there with the changes in the climate, and certainly it is apparent. We have erosion issues and we have melting sea ice, of course. So what I've done up there is form a sub-cabinet to focus solely on climate change, understanding that it is real. And
is it man-made, though, in your view?
You know, there are man's activities that can be contributed to the issues that we're dealing with now with these impacts. I'm not going to solely blame all of man's activities on changes in climate because the world's weather patterns are cyclical, and over history we have seen changes there. But kind of doesn't matter at this point as we debate what caused it. The point is, it's real. We need to do something about it.
We also talked about her positions on a number of social issues.
If a 15-year-old is raped by her father, You believe it should be illegal for her to get an abortion. Why?
I am pro-life, and I'm unapologetic about my position there on pro-life, and I understand good people on both sides of the abortion debate. Now, I would counsel to choose life. I would like to see a culture of life in this country, but I would also like to see taking it one step further, not just saying I am pro-life and I want fewer and fewer abortions in this country, but I want then those women who find themselves in circumstances that are absolutely less than ideal for them to be supported, for adoptions to be made easier.
But ideally, you think it should be illegal for a girl who is raped or the victim of incest to get an abortion?
I'm saying that personally, I would counsel that person to choose life despite horrific, horrific circumstances that this person would find themselves in. And if you're asking, though, kind of foundationally here, should anybody end up in jail for having had an abortion? Absolutely not. That's nothing that I would ever support.
Some people have credited the morning after pill as for decreasing the number of abortions. How do you feel about the morning after pill?
Well, I'm all for contraception, and I'm all for any preventative measures that are legal and safe and should be taken. But Katie, again, I am one to believe that life starts at the moment of conception, and I would like to see fewer and fewer abortions in this world. And again, I haven't spoken with anyone who disagrees with my position on that.
I'm sorry, I just want to ask you again, do you condone or condemn the morning after pill?
Personally, and this isn't a McCain-Palin policy
administration policy. No, that's okay, I'm just asking you.
But personally, I would not choose to participate in that kind of contraception.
Do you believe evolution should be taught as an accepted scientific principle or one of several theories?
Oh, I think it should be taught as an accepted principle. And you know, I say that also as the daughter of a school teacher, a science teacher, who has really instilled in me a respect for science. It should be taught in our schools. And I won't ever deny that I see the hand of God in this beautiful creation that is Earth, but that is not part of a policy or a local curriculum in a school district. Science should be taught in science class.
The governor told us, though she's not a member of any church, she visits a couple of them regularly when she's home. She took issue with news reports that one of them, the Wasilla Bible Church, sponsored a conference where gays could be made straight through prayer.
When the media gets it wrong, it frustrates Americans who are just trying to get the facts and be able to make up their mind on about a person's values. And you know, I don't know what prayers are worthy of being prayed, and I don't know what prayers are going to be answered or not answered. But as for homosexuality, I am not going to judge Americans and the decisions that they make in their adult personal relationships. I have one of my absolute best friends for the last 30 years who happens to be gay, and I love her dearly, and she is not my gay friend. She is one of my best friends who happens to have made a choice that isn't a choice that I have made, but I'm not going to judge people.
People may judge her after Thursday's debate, where she'll be unfiltered and unedited, something reporters complain the campaign has resisted.
The campaign knows that I am an open book. My record is out there, and my life is out there.